started worrying about you, Brother Hogan. I said, I hope the creek don't rise. My man says, I'll see you Sunday if the creek don't rise. Ain't that right? I said, oh, Lord, the creek might be rising today. But you made it here. You made it here. Y'all made it here. You made it here. It's good. And it's good. Well, let me tell you, brother, if the creek rises, you can come stay at the house for a couple days till it gets down. That'll be all right, huh? Announcements I have. The next thing we have going on is next Sunday night is our fifth Sunday night, and we're having singing at Beaver Dam. So next Sunday night, same time, 6 o'clock, we can meet at Beaver Dam, bring a dessert. We'll eat afterwards. Bring dessert, be just music, that's it. So preach over there, maybe read like one verse of scripture, pray or something like that, but that'd be about it, then we'll go straight in and sing. So, our next Family of Faith is February the 7th, and we are having casseroles. And I do believe there's a list of casseroles started down here. So you can add your name and what you're going to bring so we don't have a whole bunch of one thing. Looks like a pretty good list going so far. So it should be good. Wednesday night I talked about us starting a new fundraiser, not fundraiser, but a project.
Collection.
A project, a collection of what to do next. And we've done Meals on Wheels before, and they've been on my heart lately. I like to do a thing for Meals on Wheels. So what we do is we collect the big cans, like about a gallon size can, I think they are. Anything you want to get, doesn't matter what it is. And we'll just collect them back there. And once we get so many, we'll start putting them out here out front to give a little reminder to people to bring cans in. And I'll try to drop them off. Anybody welcome to go with me, want to go? Probably around the first week of March. So that way it gives us, you know, a month and a half for better to collect. So they really, really appreciate it. They use a bunch of cans. They do. So don't hurt yourself. Don't go out and buy a whole bunch. Just when you go to the grocery store, pick up a can or two. You know, do what God lays on your heart to do. Do what God lays on your heart to do. Anything else? Well, I'll turn it over to our minister.
Page 343. You see the words up here. We'll sing all that.
Blessing you lay on the creek or deep, all this morning, Father, everyone in here, give blessing, Reverend Father. Take this off, and you feel glory in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. within my heart, this Lamb of Rose, there rose a Lamb in Jerusalem. He was the Son of the Great I Am. He proved to be my victory.
Several times this week, and she can be my witness to tell you that. But we're going to be in Genesis 34 this morning, and we're going to see what happens. We'll need the Lord's help this morning. Even though I done read it, I still need help. But we're going to be in Genesis 34, chapter 34, verse 1. And let me read here a little bit. And Dinah, the daughter of Leah, which she bare unto Jacob, went out to see the daughters of the land. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, prince of the country, saw her, he took her and lay with her and defiled her. Let me stop right there before we go any further. Did y'all see the downward progression of sin? Sin never shows you the consequences behind it. There's pleasures in sin. And I'd be lying to you if I said there wasn't pleasures in sin. The Bible says there is. The pleasures of sin. in for a season. That's how the Bible states it, okay? The difference between the pleasures of the Lord is, and the song says, the fullness of out of the right hand, there's pleasures not for a season, the pleasures are forever. So there's a difference. The season of pleasure with the Lord never runs out. It never runs out. David said, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. It never runs out. Sin's only fun for a little while, but then it will come to an abrupt screeching halt in your life. That's what happened with sin. And it did for Samson. It did for David. It did for Solomon. It did for Lot. It did for Judas. It did for the prodigal son. And it will for you. You're no exception. This ain't my message, but I'm taking myself up already. You're not going to slide by and just do your sin and get by. You can't live a rebellious life towards God and think everything's going to be just fine. The season will come to an end. It will. It just runs out. Sooner or later, you won't have to pay the piper. Sooner or later. Let me get back. Verse 3. And his soul clave unto Dinah, the daughter of Jacob. And he loved the damsel, and spake kindly unto the damsel. And Shechem spake unto his father, Hamor, saying, get me this damsel to wife. And Jacob heard that he had defiled Dinah, his daughter. I have many, many questions about this daddy in the text. I do. I have so many problems with this daddy in the text. Great men aren't always great. Jacob is certainly a great man. The Bible says so. The Bible says that he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But here's a chapter right here that I got to say, man, sir, you ain't no kind of, what kind of wacko are you? You gonna give your young daughter to this pervert? You know, you're gonna do that. He defiled her. You understand what that means? I don't have any children, but I do have nieces and great nieces, and I love them dearly. And let me tell you, I gotta be honest with you this morning. For anybody, think about anybody looking at them or touching them in the wrong way, it makes me want to hurt them. I'm being honest with y'all up here this morning. She knows how I feel about them kids. No. The world full of evilness right now, ungodly people. It is. So you got to watch out for your youngins at all times, every place. You do. You got to watch out for them. You do. Let me try to read this text. Back to verse 5. And Jacob heard that he had defiled Dinah, his daughter. Now his sons were with his cattle in the field, and Jacob held his peace until they were come. And Hamor, the father of Shechem, went out unto Jacob to commune with him. And the sons of Jacob came out of the field when they heard it, and the men were grieved and were very wroth, because he had wrought folly in Israel and lying with Jacob's daughter, which thing ought not to be done. Heavenly Father, I come to you this morning, and I say, Father God, give me help. I'm only a man. I'm nothing without you, and I realize that. So help me, Father, to say what you want me to say, and help open up everyone's ears to hear what you need them to hear. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Jacob's son, Simeon and Levi, they have a little plan worked out. I don't know if y'all read this or not. They have a little plan worked out that basically they tell them that they're not circumcised. If you get circumcised, we can be family. And we can trade amongst each other and just get along just great. But they did that. with something in their heart, letting them know that that really wasn't their plan. That wasn't their plan. They had a plan on destroying those men. It was their plan in the background. I want to jump to chapter 34, verse 25. Verse 25, I want to read something here to you. It says, and it came to pass on the third day. Now these men that got circumcised now. Now you got to realize, when we circumcise people now, we circumcise people with kids, babies, newborns, just a couple days old. These are grown men, all right? They're getting circumcised, all right? And it came to pass on the third day when they were sore that two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brother, took each man his sword and came upon the city boldly and slew all the males. And they slew Hamor and Shechem his son with the edge of the sword and took Dinah out of Shechem's house and went out. The sons of Jacob came upon the slain and spoiled the city because they had defiled their sister. I can't have one of them. I ain't gonna lie to you. I want y'all to, would y'all agree with me here this morning, on the onset of this message, that this is a real messed up story in the Word of God. It's a real messed up story. It starts bad, it continues bad, and it ends bad. But it is a true story. It is a true story. There's absolutely no joy in chapter 34. None. One thing that struck in my mind when I read this, that's why I kept reading it. Someone went across you this morning. Do you realize when you read your Bible and you start out in Genesis chapter 1, and you read all the way up to Genesis chapter 34, there is not one chapter that does not mention God or Lord in it until you get to chapter 34. And when you get to chapter 34, they leave God out of it. And without God in the chapter, it seems like it was nothing but disaster. It was just one big disaster without God in it. If you leave God out of a chapter, it usually turns out bad. Turns out bad. Like I said, it's a disaster. So I'm going to preach on a few minutes this morning on the thought was writing a chapter in life without God. Writing a chapter in life without God. Or the dangers of living a chapter in life without God. You realize your life is like a book. You know, Moses said in Psalm 90, we spend our years as a tale that is told. You know, like a story, like a tale. It's a story. It's a story. Paul said in his epistles that ye are living epistles known and read of all men. In other words, your life is like a book. Your life is a book. Moses and Paul both say that. Your life is a book. But in your life, since it is like a book, we go through different chapters in our life. We have adolescence. We have young adulthood. We have marriage. We have fatherhood and motherhood, and so on. I don't know what chapter in your life you happen to be in right now, or what season that you're in. I mentioned seasons before. But we all in our own chapter, in our own books. What I want to make sure is that we don't leave God out of our chapters, out of your chapter. You don't leave him out. Make sure the Lord is in the beginning and in the middle and in the end. Make sure the Lord is all the way through your chapter. The few chapters, you can't afford with the few chapters that you have, you can't afford to leave your mountain. You can't leave God out of your chapters. You can't. God ought to be in the center of your chapter. If not, it can come out being ruin and destruction like this. Like this. Like I said earlier, there's pleasures in sin. But none of us are exception to the rule. It will come back to hurt us. It will come back to hurt us. I know people think that, well, I can write this chapter in my life without God and everything's going to be fine. People have that thought. It's not going to turn out all right. It's not. Can anybody here agree with this preacher this morning and say that has walked down some rough roads and went through some chapters in their life that did not include God, and it did not turn out the way you thought it was going to turn out to? Amen. I know I can. The chapters I left them out didn't turn out the way I thought they would. They didn't. You know, chapters that you did not make him a priority. Him, his church, reading his Bible, you kind of put on the back burner. You did your own thing. It's not good. You can't look back and say those were the best chapters of my life. A lot of times you look back with guilt and pain and things that you did wrong that you know you shouldn't have done. But you look back at them and say, man, how would they have changed if I had God in the center of that chapter? It wouldn't have been like it was. It wouldn't have been like it was. You know? Don't leave God out of your chapter. I want to touch on a couple points before I get to my main points. What are the dangers here? I want to do this quickly if I can. Of writing a chapter without God. Without God. The first thing is her contemplating is wrong. I'm talking about Dinah. Her contemplating was wrong. I know she's the one that got involved, but her contemplating was wrong. Let me read to you 34:1 again. And Dinah, the daughter of Leah, which she bare unto Jacob, went out to see the daughters of the land. Why is she looking out there? Why is she trying to yoke up with people who are her people? She's a child of God. Those ain't the child of God that she's looking at. Why is she looking out at those people? Looking out into the world. Those people ain't us. Those people are different than us. Do we need to try to bring them in? Yes. But when you look out there, and there is a danger in it, because they're going to try to suck you in to their ways. To their ways. This world is going to throw junk up in your face, young people. Let me talk to you young people for just a minute. The world is going to throw junk up in your face. They're going to say, oh, you're going to miss all the parties. You're going to miss all the suds and the buds. You're going to miss out on all that. You ain't missing out on a thing. You ain't missing out on one thing. I'm telling you that right now. There's not one adult in here that's lived that life can sit here and tell you it ain't worth it. It ain't worth it. It ain't worth it. You're not missing one thing out there with that stuff. Drinking beer, carrying on. You ain't missing nothing. Ain't missing nothing. But she's not of that land, and you're not of that land either. You're a child of the King. You're not. You're not. You know. We're children of heaven. Is who we are. We're a child of the King. We're heaven bound with the hammer down. Think about that. Think about that. That's what we are. We're born again. We washed with the blood. That's who we are. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit and the promise. We're strangers. We're pilgrims. We're just passing through this land. That's all we're doing. That's all we're doing. So what I tell you, don't gaze out into that world and think about, oh man, that's got to be better over there. It's not. It's not. Don't let your contemplation be wrong. In this chapter about God, they weren't thinking straight. When you leave God out, we don't think straight. You leave God out of your life, you don't think right. Think about it. What would Jesus do before you do it? Or think, Jesus is with me right now. Do you think he wants to be in this place? Think about that before you do it. That might help you not go that route. Might help you. You know, like I said, you'll think, man, how did I think that way later in life? Once you get back in track, how did I think that way? You don't think right when you're living that way. You know. I got another one here. There's a contamination that's wicked. Verse 2. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, prince of the country, saw her, he took her and lay with her and defiled her. Okay? He defiled her. Through this whole book, there ain't nothing but destruction. I hope none of y'all are writing a chapter right now in your life that's leaving him out. Or some of you may be thinking about writing a chapter and leaving him out. I'm trying to help you not do that. I don't want you to do that. You know? One day you'll look back and say, man, that preacher was right. It's not because I'm right, it's because the book's right. It's because the book's right. It's not me, it's the book. You know? That's what's right. I want you to think about something. She was out looking, but somebody was looking at her. And Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hittite prince, saw her. He saw her. Do you realize when you're out and about, you got to be sober. You got to be vigilant. You got to look and see what's around your surroundings. You need to know. Why? Because the devil is a roaring lion walking about seeking. She's getting watched, just like she was watching. You know, she said, "I didn't expect none of this to happen." She laying up in the corner, all upset, in the corner of the house, and said, "All I was doing was wanting to go out and look. Well, this boy was looking too. This boy was looking too. He was on the prowl. He was on the hunt, and he defiled her." I said, "She never thought it would end up that way." Satan never shows you the backside of the story. He just shows you the front side where it's all pretty. That's what he shows you, what looks good. He don't show you how that sin is going to end up messing you up. It ends as a catastrophe that's wild, the ending. Verse 30. Verse 30. And Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, "Ye have troubled me to make me to stink among the inhabitants of the land, among the Canaanites and the Perizzites, that I being few in number, they shall gather themselves together against me and slay me, and I shall be destroyed. I am my house." And they said, "Should he deal with our sister as with and harlot?" It was a harlot. Like I said, I read you the beginning of the book, and I read you the end of the book. It is a wake of destruction from beginning to end. The whole book is nothing but destruction. But it's a chapter that God left out of it. God left out of it. Like I said, I hope y'all aren't writing a chapter that way. How do we avoid this? We avoid it by not leaving God out of a chapter. I got three things that I want to bring to you real quick that I think that will help us to try to avoid leaving God out of a chapter of our life. The first point is, he relied on past experiences. He's talking about Jacob. He relied on past experience. If you read the life of Jacob, Jacob comes on the scene in chapter 27. And he gets a blessing from his daddy. He did it deceitful. He didn't act like he was his brother, Esau. But God still honored him, and he was blessed. God still honored his dad's blessings, and God blessed him. In chapter 28, he runs down to Bethel. And when he gets to Bethel, he goes to sleep, and a ladder comes down from heaven. Okay? And he talks with the angels. Don't talk to angels. Ladder comes down, he talks to God, and it changes his life completely. Changes his life. When he gets down to his uncle's house, his uncle Laban, God blesses him. He gives him wives. He gives him children. He gives him cattle and sheep and everything else. You know, and God blesses him. And then he's there. And on his way home, he's there approximately 20 years. And on his way home, he meets with some angels. Angels talk to him. You know, so he's just getting blessed after blessed after blessed. There's one point that he actually wrestles with an angel. He wrestles with an angel. And when he wrestles with an angel, he pops his thigh out. And he walks a whole different life. God walks like me. He walks in a whole different life. But what he's doing is he's getting blessed after blessing after blessing. He just keeps getting blessed. And it's just an over and over and over thing. But in chapter 33, in chapter 34, we never see no communion with God. You don't have any communion with God. It's like, it's a past thing. I done seen all this. I done seen blessings. I done seen all this. It's an old thing. It just comes by. It just happens. It just happens. And that's what we have to worry about. We have to worry about thinking, you know, our blessings. We're not seeing these blessings. You know, that's how a church can lose its blessings. They can say, well, you know, I've seen all that before. I don't shout no more at church because I used to shout, but I don't need to shout no more. I've seen sinners saved. That's just all the time. Happens all the time. Happens all the time. I don't want to live a life where I think all that's in the past. I want to live a life to say that I'm not a yesterday Christian, I'm a today Christian. I'm going to keep seeing blessings in this church, in my life. Amen. They're not done. They're going to keep coming. They're going to keep coming, you know? Something that is done. It's over with. I can't see it no more. I've seen all that stuff. It's done. It's over with. I don't know what God you're serving, but I'm serving a living God. Like my man said a little bit ago, I'm serving a living God. I'm serving the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the Almighty God, the everlasting Father. My Bible says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He don't change.
Right.
We don't have to live on stale bread or stagnant water. We don't live on none of that. We don't have to live on yesterday blessings. We serve a God with exceedingly abundantly able to do more than we could ever ask or think. That's who we serve. He's still in the serving business. He's still in the changing life business. He's still in the saving soul business. He don't quit. He don't quit. Don't stop your fellowship with God because it was an old thing. We should keep growing in grace. Keep growing in knowledge. We should never quit. That's why I give y'all a reading plan every first of the year. We should keep reading our Bible. Keep reading our Bible. I don't know how many times I read my Bible and I never seen this story jump out on me like it did this week. So I read it over again. I read it over again. Don't think you're done seeing God's blessings, because he's not done. He's not done. Second point is he resisted God's prescription. Just a little bit of rebellion here in Jacob's life. Yes, he had a little bit of rebellion in his life. In chapter 31, verse 3, I want to read this to you. 31, verse 3. And the Lord said unto Jacob, return to the land of thy fathers and thy kindred, and I will be with thee. What he said? Go back home, and I will be with you. What he says. That land is Beersheba. Okay? He says, go back home, and I'll be with you. What he says. But where he goes to is chapter 33, verse 17. And Jacob journeyed to Succoth. That ain't where he told him to go. He told him to go back home. He didn't go back home. Okay? And built him a house and made booths for his cattle. Therefore, the name of the place is called Succoth. Okay? That's what it says. And Jacob came to Shechem, a city of Shechem, which is in the land of Canaan, when he came from Padan, and pitched his tent before the city. And he bought a parcel of a field where he had spread his tent at the hand of the children of Hamor, Shechem's father, for 100 pieces of money. I looked this up on my Bible maps and seen where he was supposed to. He's leaving his uncle's house, Laban's, and where he's supposed to go is Beersheba. And I looked it up, that's like a 500-mile journey. 500 miles back then is a long way to go. It's a long way to go. 500 miles now in a car is still 8-9 hours. So can you imagine on a camel, you know, pushing cattle and livestock? That's a long way to go. But anyway, he comes up just a little bit short. Where he ends up at is about 100 miles from where God told him to go. Okay? He gets there. He didn't obey God. You have to remember, partial obedience is total rebellion. We don't do what he tells you to do. You might not have done any of it. You say, well, I got there close. I'm only 100 miles, 400 miles. God, I'm close to where you told me to go. You know? Some people think the same way. I'm not what I used to be. I've come a long way. I'm a lot better than I was. But have you gone where God told you to go? Have you gotten where God told you to be at? You know? You got to keep growing in the Lord. Preachers preach on music all the time. What music you're supposed to listen to. I ain't preached on that yet. Maybe I will one day. Who knows? People say, well, preacher, it's just music. It's just a song. But when you hear that song, does it not take you back to when you used to listen to that song, to that place that you were at that you shouldn't have been at? Maybe it put a taste in your mouth that you used to have, a smell in your nose you used to have. Does it take you back to where you were when you shouldn't have been there in the first place? Music does it for some people. It does. It does. You may say, I don't drink no more. I don't drink no more. I'm sorry, preacher. Maybe I drink just one beer. Maybe I drink just one beer watching the game with the boys. Just one. It's hard to tell me if one don't turn into two. And two don't turn into more. You know? It's okay. I can handle it. I'm just with the guys. It's a social drink. Everything's good. You know? Is it? You know, I'm just trying to get them boys, I'm trying to pull them boys out of where they're at. No, you're not. they're going to pull you down where they at, is what happens. They pull you back down, you know, trying to help them out. They pull you back. He even got close to worship in this. He said he got close to worship, yeah, in chapter 33, verse 20. And he erected there an altar and called it Elohei Israel, is what he called it. That means the God of Israel, is what it means. That's like saying, well, I'm a little bit religious. I come to church on Sundays. I just don't do everything else right. But I'm kind of religious a little bit. I do a little bit. That's basically what that's saying right there. I do a little bit. I'm close. But before I turn you loose, I'm going to give you a little bit of help. I always got to get the bad out before I give you the good. I got some help for you. I'm going to turn you loose. It's going to be quick. He returned to the place. Returned to the place. The story don't end like this, folks. Thank God the story don't end there. Chapter 35. We got to get on chapter 34 to get there. Chapter 35. And God said unto Jacob. Hear that? God said to Jacob. God said to Jacob. Is what he said. Ain't it great? God come to us in the darkest days of our life. He don't give up on us. He comes to us. He says something next to us. He hugs us. Says, I love you. I'm here for you. I get you out of this mess. Write me in your chapter. Write me in your chapter. It says, and then it says, arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother. Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean and change your garments. That's how you get back close to God. You're going back, okay? First thing is, you're going to get rid of those false gods. They're gone. They're gone. It's the first thing we're doing. First thing we're going to do. Then we're going to clean up. That's what you do. You throw away them gods, and you clean up. And we're going to change our garments. So what they're going to do is, they're going to clean up, and get rid of them false gods, and they're going to God's house. They're going to church. That's how you get back, line back up. Verse 3, and let us arise and go to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. Them kids of his weren't there when he first ran into God. He was on his way before he even got married. He was on his way there, and he had his encounter with God. The same thing with a lot of y'all. Y'all got saved before you start having a family. A lot of you did. Some of you got saved afterwards. But they weren't with him. He said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to go back to God's house. This is what we're going to do. We're going to make things right. We're going to straighten up. That's what we're going to do. Okay? And they gave God unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears, and Jacob... Y'all ready for this? And Jacob hid them under the oak, which was by Shechem. Okay. So they empty their hands. That's the first thing you do. You empty your hand, you come here with a problem, and you give it to God. It's a song we just sang, nailed to the cross. Empty your hands, give it to God. Earrings, you're going to clean your ears so you can hear what this crazy preacher got to say. You're going to clean your ears. Okay? And then you're going to throw it under the oak. You're going to throw it under the cross. You're going to leave it at the cross. You're going to take your sin and your problems and throw it at the cross. That's what you do. That's what you do. You throw it at the cross. I want to tell you, folks, this is what me and that woman here have done. We took our ink pen.
And we took our book, and I decided I wasn't gonna write no chapters. We're gonna give it to God. I said, you write my book. You write it, not me. It is what it is. Here it is, God. It's empty. You write it, you tell me what you want us to do. We give it to God. Let him have it all. Let him have it all. That's my recommendation for everyone. That way you don't need God out of any of your chapters if he's right. If he's right. He's got it all. Let him have it. We have a song in this.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily.
Thank you for the rain that you gave us this morning. We say we're going to get a lot today, and you know what we need, and we thank you for it. You give it to us. We're so grateful. Now, Heavenly Father, I ask you to bless us all, bless this church, bless everyone who wanted to come and couldn't come for whatever reason, Father God. I ask you, God, drag us and be with us, and keep us all safe from all harm, and bring us back to the next appointed time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.